added to Georgia State's increasing national profile, Dr. Becker has fostered the development of NCAA Division I athletics. With the Atlanta Braves' decision to vacate Turner Field, Dr. Becker has also led the university's acquisition and renovation of a stadium that has become home for Georgia State football. Prior to his appointment at Georgia State, Dr. Becker served as Executive Vice President for Academic Affairs and Provost at the University of South Carolina. He also has held administrative leadership roles at the University of Minnesota and the University of Michigan, and has held academic positions at the University of Washington, the University of Florida, and Cornell University. Please join me in welcoming the President of Georgia State University, Dr. Mark Becker.
Thank you. I'm going to actually try to speak from here. Can you hear me? I can project pretty well in the bigger rooms than this. So thought what I would do this evening is part of this, tell you the story of this facility and how we got to what we have behind us, which is a football stadium and what used to be an Olympic stadium and then a baseball stadium. But I thought where I'd start is actually with my journey through the Big Ten. It's actually great to be at a Big Ten event because in my experience in higher ed, which is started in the Big Ten as a graduate student at Penn State in 1980, there is no other athletic conference that rivals the Big Ten in terms of the excellence in athletics and academics. Some folks may claim the Pac-12, but I don't think it's quite at the same level as the Big Ten. I'm extremely proud that in the 37 years since I graduated college, I spent 20 of them affiliated with Big Ten institutions as a student, as a professor, as a dean. So it's really had a big part of my life. I've learned a tremendous lot amount, first as a graduate student at Penn State, 1980 to 85, then a faculty member at the University of Michigan, 1989 to December 2000, and then a dean at the University of Minnesota, January 2001 to the summer of August of 2004. So I've been around a few places. I have been on every Big Camp 10 campus in some time, except for two. Are there any Northwestern grads here? Okay, so I have not been on the Northwestern campus. I've driven by it. I've never been on the campus. And I don't believe I've ever been in the state of Nebraska, which is one of only one or two states I've never been in the lower 48. But a different way to look at my journey through the Big Ten is to do it in the context of athletics, since we're in an athletic community. So what I can tell you is my journey through championships. So at Penn State in my years there, in 1981, we won the women fencing national championship and field hockey. Football, 1982, which I have talked about a lot in this town, because it was in the Sugar Bowl in 1983, that Penn State defeated the Georgia Bulldogs and Herschel Walker to win the national championship. 86 again, in a game that I don't think any Penn Stater will ever forget, the Fiesta Bowl. Probably the best coached game in the history of college football championships. There's no question that Miami had a more athletic talent, but Penn State had a better coach and a better scheme. And I guarantee you, every time a Miami receiver touched the football, they felt it. By the fourth quarter, they dropped every pass, and they won the game, including on the final pass. And then also 1983, men's fencing. So those were Penn State championships, five in total. Then move on to Ann Arbor. I was in Seattle when Michigan won the NCAA basketball championship, but I didn't get to Ann Arbor until 6 months later. So it was not officially affiliated with Michigan at that point. I was being recruited by them while they were busy of winning. Actually, I'd been recruited. I'd already accepted the job at Michigan. I was not employed by them when they won March Madness in spring of 1989. So 1995, men's swimming diving and men's gymnastics. 1996 and 98, men's ice hockey. The best team they had was 97, but that team didn't win, so they won the year before and they won the year before. The most talented team set up. But in 97, we did win the football national championship, beating Washington State in the Rose Bowl, and a Heisman Trophy winner not have much of that. I'll leave it to you to figure out who that was.
Desmond?
Brian Lee.
Brian? You beat him.
Was the Washington State quarterback. I was in Michigan Stadium when Desmond Howard did the Heisman Trophy pose. I had to explain to my son that this was not a normal football game, and that's not how they all happen. It's about 12. Move on to the University of Minnesota, 2001, 2002, Wrestling National Championships. 2002 men's golf, one of the greatest upsets in men's golf history. Usually men's golf is not won by Big Ten schools. It's usually won by schools like Arizona, Texas, Oklahoma State, schools that have a lot more warm weather. But that year, trivial fact, is the men's golf championship was played at the Ohio State University. in 40 or 50 degree weather and rain and wind. That's why the Gophers won that game. It was their kind of weather. It was not your typical NCAA golf. Men's hockey championships 2002, 2003, and women's hockey 2004. So interestingly, when you put all that together, even though I was at these three institutions for different periods of time, five national championships at Penn State, five at Michigan, and six at Minnesota. Who ever knew that Minnesota was a big athletic powerhouse? The Gophers did. It was a lot of fun. Now, one of the things that happens when you have these multiple allegiances is you have to decide who to root for when they play each other, which we do every year, because that's part of being the same conference. So it was in 1994 that I had faced this dilemma for the first time. Penn State came into the Big Ten in 93, and they were playing Michigan in 94. And at that point, my son, who to this day at age 31 bleeds Mason Blue. He's a 3-month-old son. He has his Michigan onesie. He has it on every Saturday. His grandfather provided it. But in 1994, so in 1994, he was 8. So he asked me the all-important question, Dad, who are you going to root for? And I said, well, Matthew, this is a really easy question to answer. I'm going to root for the team with the best chance of going to the Rose Bowl. This is all pre-BCS. Because I want one of my teams in the Rose Bowl. That year it was Penn State, and I made an 8-year-old cry. He thought I had betrayed him and the Wolverines. I have since redeemed myself with the Wolverines. So let me transition from that experience to Georgia State. So first, just a couple of quick facts about Georgia State. It is now the largest institution in the state of Georgia, roughly 53,000 students. About 33,000 of those are downtown, literally 1 mile north of here. The rest are distributed across our five perimeter campuses. For your Penn State, it's very similar to the branch campuses in the Penn State model, except that they're all in the metro Atlanta area. We are one of the most diverse universities in the nation. There is no majority student population, meaning whether you're African American, Caucasian, Asian, or Hispanic, they're all less than 50%. Roughly representing the state of Georgia in population, except that whites are a little bit less in their state representation and Asians are a little overrepresented. But generally, very similar to the state's population. In terms of some of the things that we've accomplished, U.S. News and World Reports now for 2 years in a row has ranked us the fourth most innovative university in the country, behind Arizona State, MIT, and Stanford. And our claims to innovation are really around how we have re-engineered, redesigned the university so that the university is designed around the student experience. Whereas most universities, almost all universities historically, have designed the university for the faculty and staff to work there and then invite the students in to participate. We really look at how does the student experience the university, and if we find that we have designed a university that is difficult for students to navigate, meaning that it has all sorts of bureaucracy that's unnecessary, we try to change that and make it work. We've also been, this year, we're very pleased, we moved from 14th, just behind Michigan last year, to number 8 in the country for best undergraduate education. Michigan is 6th this year, so they also moved up, so we're proud of that. We're number 8, tied with that school of Palo Alto known as Stanford, immediately ahead of Duke, and the one in New Haven called Yale. So we're very pleased with that, our commitment to undergraduate education. We also do all the graduate stuff. We've got one of the fastest research, fastest growing research portfolios in the country, particularly in terms of NIH. There's a lot going on, big place, complicated, and it's my 15 years in the Big Ten really helped set me up to deal with that level of size and complexity. Football, on the other hand, is a very recent occurrence. The university took up the study of whether or not it would have football. Alumni had asked for football for a long time. There had been club teams. The formal exploration of developing an NCAA football program did not start until November of 2006. It was in April of 2008 that they decided that they would go forward with football. You have to get that approved by your governing board, the Board of Regents for the University System of Georgia. So that was approved in April of 2008. My predecessor, who had said there would be no football, did agree to it and did agree to get that, to make that recommendation, and then he announced his retirement. And so in October of 2008, I was offered this job, and I arrived in January 1, 2009. On my first visit to the campus in November of 2008, I was coming over to meet with my predecessor as we started the process of transition, and I had just been named. So I called his assistant and I said, call the basketball coach and the football coach, they want to meet. Because one thing you learn in this business is coaches of major sports get really nervous about changing leadership transition. So met with both the coaches, but I'll never forget meeting with the football coach. Bill Curry, somewhat of a legend here in Atlanta, played at Georgia Tech, coached at Georgia Tech, had a lot of success, coached at Alabama, coached at Kentucky, a real icon of college football here. And my first conversation with Bill probably did not start off the way that he expected. He said, Coach, when I was a kid, I had your football card when you were in the NFL. And I was about 20 years younger than you. Still am. it was a great start. And he says, well, Dr. Becker, I'm the coach. I've got one recruit. I don't have a place to practice. We don't have uniforms. We don't have helmets. We got a lot of work to do. And that was, we set to it. Right away. And Bill did everything, including that first year we practiced on a old lot not far from here that had broken glass on it, bees nested in the ground, and all sorts of nasty stuff. But we've come a little way since then. 2013, if I remember correctly. Yeah, 2013. We actually make the move to FBS, bowl football. Before that, in 2010, 11, and 12, we had played in FCS, which we used to call Division 1A back in the day. There was 1A and 1A. Now it's FCS and FBS. And we pretty quickly came to the realization that there really wasn't a lot of future there, not the least of which, in the FCS level, there is a national championship. It is actually the official NCAA football championship. When you watch the football championship, which will be played here in Atlanta this year, that is not an NCAA championship. The college football bowl system does not belong with the NCAA. The NCAA's main event, if you will, is March Madness. That's the overwhelming majority of the NCAA's revenue, even though football is a big part of that. But FCS is the official NCAA championship. Bowl series is separate from the NCAA. But that was one of the things we realized. One is that there's no media contracts in FCS. And the second is alumni rather go to a bowl game than the FCS championship. You get much better turnout for bowl games than the FCS championship. So we came in to the Sun Belt Conference in 2013. In 2015, we had our first bowl eligibility. We went to our first bowl game. We played in the Cure Bowl in Orlando and promptly lost to San Jose State. Proudly, I can say we are already bowl eligible this year, and as of today, we're in a four-way tie for first place. Things are getting better. And that's what I'll conclude my remarks on is this facility, because that's a big part of things getting better. I will never forget the day, November, I don't know the exact date, even though it wouldn't be hard to find, November 2013.